So, April, I wonder what you would sort of say to review year one as we look ahead to year two. What would you say has been the success or the failure of the White House press corps?
Well, the success of the White House press corps is that we continue to do our job, and we're going to continue to do our job. We have the White House Correspondents Association that represents us, but, you know, there has been a war on the press by the White House, led by this president. And you said a very big word that really resonates, and it really touched me, hit me, when you said it's poisonous, because it is. Because, you know, I've talked to other reporters, you know, we've gotten death threats, you know, being on the road sometimes, some of the reporters are saying, at a moment's notice, the crowd could turn. And, you know, just recently...
April, let me ask you, you just said death threats. You just said death threats for reporting?
Yeah. Death threats.
Sick.
Yes. For asking questions and reporting. Yes. Yes. Yes.
And that's for you personally?
It's real.
What do you do?
And that's me personally. What do? You talk to your company, and your company has the FBI and the local police on speed dial. You know, just for asking questions. I mean, you know, people are taking this to a whole nother degree. We've been doing this for a long time. The same questions I've asked this president, I've asked other presidents. But, Brian, the only question that I've never asked a president, and no one else has, are you racist? But still, we have a right. We are ingrained in the First Amendment, freedom of the press. There is a back and forth for a reason. We're the fourth estate, a powerful fourth estate. That's part of the accountability piece. And this separates us from Russia, from China, and third world countries that have a problem. They govern the press. We are free and independent. And there are some people, to include this president, who feels we should not ask questions. But going back to what I said, you know, we've been under attack this year. You know, and even when I asked that question about, Mr. President, are you a racist? I was asking a question. I was not condemning. I was asking because there's a groundswell. And what happens is we kind of are the conduit. We hear and throw it back to the White House. And the White House also uses us to throw back to the American public. But while I was in the Roosevelt Room that day, there was someone, a minister, who chastised me, and you could hear it on tape, for asking that question, and
right,
a series
you
of questions.
A vulture,
so
I think,
the dynamic has changed.
Yeah.
Well he called the other people
John,
a vulture when they started walking up, but he told me I shouldn't have asked the question.
John, is it as dire as April portrays it?
I don't necessarily agree with April. I do think that this being Sunday, perhaps the administration might take a lesson from the book of Isaiah when it deals with reporters. Come now, let us reason together. And I think there could be a little bit more camaraderie there and a little more conviviality and less confrontation, sometimes over little things such as the way that words are phrased. It seems right now the response of one side to the other is from the next verse of Isaiah, if ye refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured by the sword, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken. It seems to be very rancorous at this point, and we could do with a few more laughs, if you will, or a little bit more warmth. I know April will recall we had a lot of fun just before Thanksgiving telling what we were thankful for, and while some didn't like the exercise,
you had fun.
We were laughing. Yes, I did, and you gave a very good answer
you had
on
fun.
The
that
being
was kinda,
thankful
it was,
for the First Amendment.
Yeah, but I didn't give that answer. But you know, but that I felt that was condescending. But the press secretary has since said that she felt she wanted to break the ice. She felt she wanted to break the ice and thought that it was going to be taken in a way that we could all laugh about it. But for some of us, it felt, you know, like we were puppets. But you know, she explained her side and I explained my side about that. We had a conversation about it. But I mean, both sides didn't see eye to eye. But she called herself, which she told me she was trying to do something good. But It didn't come off that way.
Didn't come off
but,
that
you know,
way
I'm thankful,
to some.
I'm thankful for the three of you. Let me squeeze in
but
a break
some,
and Olivia
exactly.
Get the first word right after a quick break here. And start with you, Olivia, talking about President Trump's accessibility. He gave an interview to Reuters this week. Hasn't done any TV interviews, though, since the beginning of November. In 2 weeks, there's the Super Bowl. Historically, President Obama every year sat down with an interviewer on Super Bowl Sunday. And this time last year, Trump and Bill O'Reilly, of all people, had a Super Bowl Sunday sit down. Given the president's relative inaccessibility, how his aides seem to be keeping him from reporters, do you think he might be skipping the Super Bowl interview this year? Because Variety has reported that so far he's not committed to doing one.
Well, I mean, he is unpredictable, but it does seem like a safe bet. Throughout the last year, excluding his Fox News interviews, anytime he has done a television interview, he's made a great deal of news. And so I think his aides are probably, politically at least, correct to try to steer him away from doing that. But he does love talking to the press. I mean, we see this, the other White House correspondents on here can attest. We see this when the pool reporters are in the Oval Office, and he won't stop answering questions, even when his own aides are yelling at the reporters to leave. I think if Donald Trump had it his way, he would be on the phone with reporters and having them in the Oval Office day and night.
Right, but his aides and his lawyers sometimes don't want that.
I don't know.
John Gizzi,
right,
if you could be asking the president a single question, we're in the midst of this government shutdown, what would be the most important question to be asking the president right now, John?
The important question to ask is, are you going to stay firm the way every House Republican wants you to, and then give a clue what you'll negotiate about when the government opens, or are you going to cave? It's that simple. Everybody is wondering it right now.
April, I have about 20 seconds left. What's your question right now?
I don't have one question. I want to interview with him. I want to have a one-on-one interview with him.
Mm.
That's my question. Will you grant me an interview?
And so far, we've seen him mostly speaking to Fox and other Murdoch-owned outlets. That's why this Reuters interview this week was curious. Maybe he's opening up a bit. We will see.